I want to talk about the patient who experiences impending doom and then dies. The talk and die patient stays with us for years. These are the cases that we wonder if there's something we could have done. Let's think what we can do. When a patient has a cardiovascular death and becomes increasingly hypotensive from whatever cause, their pulse becomes harder to feel and they become altered in conscious level until they're unresponsive. When they're unresponsive with no palpable pulse, we call that cardiac arrest. But initially, the heart is often still beating when you ultrasound it. And this is a reversible situation. Physiologically, we have the sympathoexcitatory phase where your catecholamines, your stress hormones, try to compensate for a drop in cardiac output by elevating the heart rate and vasoconstricting to maintain a blood pressure. But as things collapse further, we get the sympatho-inhibitory phase as the heart slows down to try and capture more blood as it fills in diastole. And the heart rate can become slow, the patient's bradycardic, they can even vasodilate, the blood pressure plummets. When you look at vital signs of patients who are dying on intensive care units who are being palliated, an interesting common thread appears, and that is that the blood pressure, as seen by the red lines on this graph, falls fairly gradually until a systolic of somewhere around 50 to 60, in which case it then falls much more steeply and the patient arrests. So when I am told a patient has a blood pressure of 60 systolic, they have my attention, because too frequently, that is the last blood pressure we ever get on that patient. Now, the causes of cardiac arrest are often categorized as the H's and T's. That's a helpful way of thinking about it, but not a rapid way of solving the problem in real time. I prefer the 3+3 rule. These are causes of cardiac arrest, but as I've shown, hypotension, when bad enough, becomes cardiac arrest. So we can say these are causes of hypotension too. The 3+3 rule refers to volume, obstructive causes, and pump failure. And there are three main obstructive causes: tension, pneumothorax, tamponade, and massive PE. Your other H's and T's are all still embedded here. Hypokalemia and hypothermia will cause pump failure, for example. Your volume issue can be absolute, as in hemorrhage, or relative, as in severe vasodilation in sepsis or anaphylaxis. But if we use this 3+3 rule, we take a history, we examine a patient, and we use bedside ultrasound of the heart, we can differentiate pump failure from volume problems from obstruction. The top left image here shows a pump that's barely working. That's pump failure. That's a cardiogenic shock. The top right shows a hyperdynamic heart. Hyperdynamic because of hypovolemia or because of afterload reduction in sepsis or anaphylaxis. The bottom left image shows that the right ventricle is as large as or larger than the left ventricle, and in the acute situation, this might mean pulmonary embolism. And the bottom right situation shows fluid around the heart and abnormal right atrial and right ventricular diastolic filling. So that's tamponade. So rapid cardiac ultrasound will give us the answer. It'll show us where we are in this 3+3 structure. Let's talk about how this is applied to a patient. The ambulance calls with an alert. A man in his late 50s is out cycling. He's normally fit and healthy, develops chest pain, becomes extremely unwell, and the paramedics measure a blood pressure of 60. We are ready to go. We're waiting with the ultrasound machine and echo him at the front door. He comes in extremely agitated, wanting to climb off the ambulance stretcher, trying to pull the oxygen mask off his face. He looks terrible. The cardiac ultrasound shows fluid around the heart and abnormal diastolic appearance of the right-sided chambers. He has acute cardiac tamponade in the context of chest pain in a previously well patient who's now hypotensive. It's almost certainly a type A aortic dissection. In the ED, he gets pericardiocentesis to achieve ROSC and a subpericardial window to stabilize him, to go to the operating theater, where his transesophageal echo shows a dissection flap and false lumen in his aorta. On bypass, he gets his aortic root resected and a graft placed. And you can see he's delighted with the operative results and his ED care. And we've got a happy patient who did not talk and die. He made it out of hospital alive. Interestingly, a blood test comes back after he's gone to theatre, warning us of a high lactate and telling us to think about sepsis. The danger here is that people stop thinking when they see a raised lactate and start treating tamponade or massive PE or life-threatening hemorrhage as septic shock. Lactate is a sign of badness. It's not a specific sign of sepsis. Don't forego that cardiac ultrasound. The other lesson here is that the aorta will fuck you up. Always think about it. Next patient comes in, hypotensive, agitated, pulling his oxygen mask off. It's a pre-hospital alert for STEMI, and we note that the ST elevation in lead 3 is taller than the ST elevation in lead 2, suggestive of right ventricular myocardial infarction. So this man has acute RV cardiogenic shock. He comes in, he's defecated in his underwear. He's agitated. He says, I'm dying. He gets some vasoactive support on his way straight to cath lab, where he has his right coronary artery revascularized and makes a full recovery. So both these patients demonstrated these typical features of impending doom, which aren't really described together in any of the textbooks. There's things they say, there's a way they appear, and there are things they do. They say, I need to go to the toilet. I need a shit. This is the body's way during the sympathoexcitatory phase of clearing the bowels, making it ready for fight or flight. They're restless and need to move. If they're lying down, they want to sit up. If they're sitting up, they want to climb off the bed. They recognize they're dying. They tell you, I'm dying. They might ask to speak to their loved ones. They appear terrible. LLS positive. This is looking like shit. This is not a pleasant phrase and not one I use personally. But when a paramedic or a triage nurse says to me, this patient looks like shit, I know exactly what they mean. This description is of a patient that looks awful and that they might be dying. They're often pale and clammy and they sweat. But interestingly, as the sympatho-inhibitory phase kicks in and they're pre-terminal, the sweating will often stop. And this can be a very worrying sign for experienced clinicians. The things they do, they won't sit still. They're positionally restless. They have air hunger and they pull off their oxygen mask. We've all seen this. The nurse is saying, sir, keep your mask on, you need it. And the patient's ripping the oxygen mask off and gasping. This is not because of hypoxia, but it is because of organ hypoperfusion. This patient is desperately trying to improve their cardiac output. To do that, they're creating massive negative intrapleural pressures to draw blood up the IVC into the heart. So by gasping, they create negative intrathoracic pressure and they draw blood through the IVC into the heart in an attempt to augment preload and increase their cardiac output. If we put a tight-fitting non-rebreather mask on them, we're essentially asphyxiating them because they are then unable to generate these massive inspiratory flows, so they will rip the mask off in order to gasp. Let's look at an example of this in a hypovolemic patient from a television documentary of the London Helicopter Emergency Medical Services team.
Police and London ambulance paramedics are already on scene and have cordoned off the area.
My name's Simon, I'm a doctor. Can you tell me your name? What's your name? Okay. Chest is good. Belly's not too bad. So pelvis and which leg? So that femur's gone. And this one, okay.
24-year-old Victoria was on her way to work when she was involved in a collision with a lorry.
We can get some rest of the clothing off, get some more access on this side.
She was lying in an abnormal position with her right leg twisted over the left leg. There was also what looked like tire marks across the pelvis. So it was pretty clear that the wheels had gone over her pelvis and legs.
Right, so how's the circulation? She's got no radial. Pretty shocked.
She was really pale. She was gasping in an abnormal way. We couldn't measure a blood pressure. We could barely feel a central pulse. The whole picture looked as though she was bleeding to death from a major pelvic fracture.
Now, I'm happy to say this young lady made a full neurological recovery to discharge thanks to the excellent efforts of everyone in this team and the downstream carers. And you can see that she had some of the features of impending doom there. And she has a constellation of signs described by the London team specific to hemorrhage called the Hateful Eight, where they're pale, clammy, have air hunger, venous collapse, they're hypotensive with a low or falling end-tidal CO2. They could be tachy or bradycardic and have altered mental status. And some of these features you will see in all causes of hemodynamic collapse. Now, I think there's a difference between patients who have hypovolemia and patients who have obstructive shock, sometimes in how they present. Think about organ perfusion pressure. This depends on the mean arterial pressure, but also depends on the central venous pressure. And the higher the CVP for any given MAP, the lower the organ perfusion pressure. And this is why some patients with obstructive shocks who can have very high CVPs can present with impending doom, with a blood pressure that might be tolerated by a patient who's bleeding to death who will have a low CVP. So in my own experience, I've seen more of these agitated, combative, climbing off the stretcher patients in obstructive shock like tension pneumothorax or tamponade than I have in the hypovolemic patients who will sometimes slip away quietly and bleed to death. But there are exceptions on both sides. It's just an observation of mine, and I'd be interested to hear if other people have made similar observations. But at any rate, if you have a hemodynamic collapse, the patient with impending doom will have characteristic things that they say and do and the way they appear. And it's our job as resuscitationists to identify them early. If they're hypotensive, are they saying I'm dying? Are they saying I need to go to the toilet? Do they look terrible? Are they sweaty? Has the sweating stopped? And are they showing positional restlessness and ripping off their oxygen mask and demonstrating air hunger? If so, we need an immediate team approach. We need vascular access. We need an ultrasound on the chest straight away to differentiate between those obstructive causes and hypovolemia, an ECG to look for acute myocardial issues, and think about other imaging if the patient's stable enough in order to identify that aortic dissection or massive PE, etc. And then we need to act. We need to have access to immediate life-saving procedures, whether it's a clamshell thoracotomy in a penetrating cardiac injury or just decompression of a pneumothorax or rapid transfusion of blood. And we need the systems to get the patients to the definitive care, whether that's operating room, interventional radiology, or getting them onto VA ECMO. We need to build those systems. And to do all this, we have to have a mindset that we need to minimize the numbers throughout our career of the talk and die patients. We want our patients to talk and nearly die, but then live because of our interventions. That way, with patients who present with impending doom, we have a chance of outracing the Reaper. That's it. Thanks.